In the films of Budd Boetticher, the hero is a man who does the right thing without making a fuss. Boetticher's work is distinguished by a similar clarity of purpose. The director's ideas about honor and ethics are reflected in the stories that he chooses to tell and the precision with which he tells them.
I was doing my job.
You overran a village of tame Indians.
I didn't know.
You're a liar.
That's what you said in my court-martial, didn't you?
Had my way, they'd hung you.
Boetticher is best known for the B-Westerns he directed for Columbia in the 1950s and 60s, starring his favorite leading man, Randolph Scott. Five of them are gathered in a DVD box set. Ride Lonesome.
Look, Brigitte, if I was to ride south with you, there's them and see me hang.
You left a dead man in the street in Santa Cruz.
Fair fight.
He was killed from behind, like the others.
Decision at Sundown.
Some folks around here figure that Sundown doesn't need any more of Tate Kimbrough's friends.
We ain't interested in what some folks around here figure.
The Tall T.
You know what's gonna happen to you?
I think so.
You scared?
Yeah.
Well, you're honest about it, I say that for you.
Comanche Station.
Mr. Cody, I could take the stage on to Lordsburg from here. I've been enough trouble.
I started taking you back to Lords. And that I full intend to do.
And Buchanan rides alone.
You watch out who you're pushing, mister.
Just looked like your arguing wasn't getting you anywhere, and I'm a mighty hungry man. I don't want no steak that's out and out raw. Want the middle on the red side and...
This ain't a very friendly town.
All these movies were shot on location in Lone Pine, California. Boetticher and his cinematographers, including regular collaborator Lucien Ballard, who would later shoot Sam Peckinpah's The Wild Bunch, emphasized the smallness of the characters, suggesting that God or nature or the universe have no opinion on matters that seem so urgent to the human race.
I hear him.
The sky, the mountains, the rivers, and the rocks can seem oppressively vast, like a science fiction panorama or a Samuel Beckett wasteland.
Morning, Brigade.
Boetticher's films treat the Old West as a metaphoric space, an arena in which competing value systems can be tested.
Been looking to find you, Billy.
I know. Been seeing your dust for 3 days. I figured it better to let you catch up and have it out and over.
Boetticher and his crew worked quickly and often revisited locations, themes, and plots. In The Tall T, Ride Lonesome, and Comanche Station, Scott's character is a stoic in the wilderness who ends up protecting a woman and himself against criminals, double-crossing bounty hunters, or both.
My wife. Do you know who she is?
No, who?
She's old man Gateway's daughter.
So?
So he just owns the richest copper mine in the territory. Well, don't you see? You got the daughter of a millionaire. His only daughter. What do you suppose he'd pay to get her back?
It's expected that the hero would appreciate the woman more than the cold or weak man she's supposed to be with. That's a common element in all sorts of adventure stories.
You said I ought to thank you for stopping the wedding. Well, you were right about that.
What's unusual, though, is the close attention Boetticher and his screenwriters on these films, Burt Kennedy and Charles Lang, pay to the fine points of the character's moral codes. The Scott hero is attractive to the woman he protects and to the viewer, not because he's the handsomest, toughest, or most charismatic man on screen, but because he has a simple and internally consistent code of honor that he applies to everyone he meets.
I was waiting for that old man to try something.
You didn't have to kill him.
I would have sooner or later.
The Scott hero's matter-of-fact goodness stands as a rebuke to the other characters, most of whom fall into two categories. Decent folk who are living compromised lives and hating themselves for it.
Did you love him?
Yes. Yes, I did.
Mrs. Mims, you didn't love him. You never one minute thought he loved you. That's true, isn't it?
And weak, duplicitous, or cruel characters who flatter themselves into thinking they're still basically good people.
Look, Brigade, you and me going against each other, it just ain't right.
Huh?
Now, I said to Whit more than once, I said I'd give most anything if we could work out something short of killing.
Such as?
Well, them dollars they're giving you to bring Billy in. I'll match them. Double if you say. Take me a while, but I'll get it.
How? Stopping coaches killing?
Well, that's all over with.
Is it?
From his rock-solid master shots to the agile cutting and kinetic camera work showcased in his action scenes, every choice in a Boetticher film, no matter how seemingly small, means something, accomplishes something. More than merely efficient, the shots communicate a vision of what human beings are and what they should be. Boetticher's subtly expressive visuals invite us to compare and contrast the Scott hero with other men, and judge them not by their height or their appearance or their clothing, but by their actions and the content of their character. The director often frames Scott and an antagonist or rival so that they're roughly the same size within the frame, as if to say, they're both just men. What makes one better than the other? Decision at sundown, which finds Scott seeking revenge against the town boss that he blames for his wife's death, contains a vivid example of how composition and choreography can subject characters to ethical scrutiny. The town doctor and the boss's bride-to-be, who were once complicit in the boss's misdeeds, are inspired by the hero's relentless pursuit of justice and begin rediscovering their own moral codes. Note how, in this scene, the bride grows larger within the frame as she crosses the room and literally stands up to her man.
Where are you going, Lucy? What's going on in here?
I don't know, Tate. But whatever it is, I like it.
As the boss, figuratively cut down to size by his bride, moves to confront the doctor, he stays the same size while the doctor grows bigger, until at last they are equals within the frame, a visual correlative for the power shift taking place between the two men. At the end of the scene, the boss beats a surly retreat into the background, becoming increasingly insignificant as the doctor takes charge of the room. Boetticher's villains are refreshingly human-sized, capable of doubt, humor, romantic yearning, even moments of empathy with their prey.
I did him a hurt once, long ago. So long I almost forgot.
And yet, as if to guard against moral confusion, Boetticher put split-screen-like partitions between the hero and the villains, and, in the hanging tree scene from Ride Lonesome, between men stained by violence and a woman with little experience of it. The fine gradations of morality become even more apparent in the box set's two town-based westerns, Decision at Sundown and Buchanan Rides Alone. The structure and story are nearly identical. Both movies find Scott's nomadic protagonist riding into a town that's in the vice grip of corruption and providing the town's citizens with a counterexample. Decision at Sundown finds the star using his decency as a bludgeon. The hero, who has vowed to kill the town boss, Tate Kimbrough, the man he blames for his wife's death, is a righteous person in a world of knaves, toadies, and sellouts. His moral absolutism makes the rest of the world squirm.
Lucy Summerton,
hold
do you
it.
Take... Well, now, look here. Everybody's welcome as long as they leave their gun in the vestibule and ain't got enough whiskey in them to make them troublesome.
You said if anybody had any objection to this wedding to speak up, that's what I'm doing.
Essentially, Decision at Sundown remade as a comedy, Buchanan Rides Alone finds Boetticher and Scott in an uncharacteristically world-weary mode. Like the towns in Akira Kurosawa's Yojimbo and Sergio Leone's A Fistful of Dollars, and the antecedent of all of these tales, Dashiell Hammett's Red Harvest, Agritown's denizens are almost comically venal, corrupt clowns who invite derisive laughter.
Lou! Lou! You gotta do something! Everybody's getting all riled up. They're gonna come down here. Ah.
Hello, Amos. Give Lou a hand counting up my money.
Scott's Buchanan hero just wants his money belt back. The hero of Sundown is a lost soul who discovers, too late, that he wasn't righteous after all.
If you killed Tate and 300 more, you still couldn't change things. You were married, but you never had a wife. Do you hear me?
Yet both towns are improved by his presence, because he's his own man.
If it wasn't for him...
Yes. He changed things for everybody in town. But unfortunately, there's nothing we can do for him. I'll tell you one thing. None of us will ever forget the day that Bart Allison's been in Sundown.